First order of business is the previous meeting minutes from October 15th. Any discussion, comments, corrections?
I have one very minor one for Alice, and that is on page 5 of the October the 15th minutes. Right down here, meets and bounds should be spelled meets correctly. I know you know how to do it, so that's it.
It's twice in that paragraph.
M-E-T-E-S. Is it really?
Yeah, again in the fourth line.
There it is, right? Two places.
That's sort of a neat meaning that way, though.
That was my only comment. Otherwise, they look
fine. Any other corrections? Comments? Seeing and hearing none, do I hear a motion?
To adopt the minutes as corrected.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? I'm sorry, before we proceed any further, we need to appoint two additional voting members. I will appoint both of our associates as voting members. I think for the entire evening, since neither Judith nor Tom will be here. Now, if there is no other discussion, all those in favor of accepting the minutes as amended, raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous. Next, we generally accept the planning board workshop minutes by consensus. Is there any discussion, any changes, corrections?
Looked fine to me.
Do I see nods? Nods and shakes, okay. The November 5th planning board workshop minutes are accepted by consensus. The correspondence that I have on hand, start with a memorandum from Ernie McVane, our code enforcement officer, to the planning board in reference to the Tinsman application, 349 Ocean House, in reference to some incomplete items according to an October 89 site plan review. A letter from, I believe it's Richard Blake, not Randy Blake. Richard Blake, who writes on the behalf of Constance Reich, owner of property abutting the previously mentioned property of Mr. Tinsman's, addressing some concerns about some of those same uncompleted items of the previous site plan. I also will submit to our planner.
Mr. Chairman, could
yes,
I ask
certainly.
If Mr. Tinsman has a copy of Ernie McVane's memo and Mr. Blake's letter?
Maureen?
I know that Mr. Tinsman has a copy of Ernie McVane's memo. I don't think he has a copy of Mr. Blake's letter.
Are you intending to give him a copy?
Sure.
Fine.
I think that's a good suggestion. Also, I will just submit for the record a copy of a letter from Tom Leahy to myself referencing Richard Davis wetlands alteration permit. You may have a, yes, you have a copy already. Mm-hmm. I'll give you my copy for now. On the podium tonight was a letter from Thomas Tinsman requesting to table the hearing on his site plan review until a December planning board meeting. Hopefully everybody has a copy of that. I think we'll simply place that with the second order of old business and take up the body of that letter at that time. Any other correspondence from board members? Okay. The first order of business tonight, it comes under old business, Stonegate Phase 4 subdivision request by Robert Taylor of Stonegate Associates and Fleet Bank of Maine to extend the time period for preliminary subdivision plan review of a 17-lot subdivision located off Stonegate Road, Section 16-2-4A8. And as I have every time in the past, I recuse myself from participation, from in this case an indirect conflict to a direct conflict of interest. I'd like to appoint Janet McKay as chair for this item.
I believe all the planning board members have the letter that's dated October the 30th, 1991, requesting the extension until the December meeting. Does anybody have any comments or questions? If not, do I hear a motion? Judith?
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the request submitted by Stonegate Associates and Fleet Bank, the applications for preliminary subdivision plan review, a wetlands alteration permit under the pre-May 90 provisions, and a permit for construction in a resource protection district under the pre-May 90 provisions for Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot major subdivision located off of Stonegate Road, be tabled to the December 1991 Planning Board meeting with the mutual agreement of both the applicants and the Planning Board.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Raise your right hand. Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, Janet.
Mm-hmm.
The next order of business under old business is the Tinsman Fitness Center request by Thomas Tinsman for site plan review of a conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of space from office use to a fitness center, public hearing, section 19-2-9. I think there are a couple of items to introduce with this. Number one, the body of the letter submitted by Mr. Tinsman. Requesting a tabling of the hearing on the site. I think we initially had given conditional approval to the completeness issue, with the condition being that certain items were submitted within 30 days. And Maureen, perhaps you can clarify this, but my understanding, those items have not been submitted, and perhaps give us a little guidance on proceeding.
Those items have not been submitted at this time. Mr. Tinsman contacted me this afternoon and indicated that he had collected the information, but did not feel that the board would be able to review it sitting here tonight, and he's asking for an extension to December so that he can package it and get it to the board in adequate time for review.
Okay, I guess my concern, and I'd like to hear some board discussion, is that the completeness was deemed, it was deemed complete, the application was deemed complete on a condition of submitting those within 30 days. Does that mean that because they weren't submitted, we go back to square one on the completeness issue?
Typically in the past, when the board has made a condition with a deadline and the applicant has missed the deadline, they're allowed to come back to the board and submit the information, even though they've missed the deadline, as long as the board gets to review it. That's what you've done in the past. I'm not aware of any time where you've done it specifically with a site plan completeness issue. So there's nothing really in the ordinance that gives you a lot of guidance. It's really at the discretion of the board how you want to handle this.
Judy?
I have a question. The funds that were required to advertise for the public hearing, did the town foot that bill, or does that? It did. Typically, if the board still wishes to hold a public hearing and we were to postpone it, I don't know if that's the board's wishes, do you re-advertise?
I would probably re-advertise, yes. I mean, you can make an assumption that anyone who got the notice or saw the notice in the paper and wanted to come to the public hearing would be here tonight, and therefore the board could make an announcement that they're rescheduling the public hearing for next month, and anyone who is interested would therefore know. That's an alternative way. Typically, unless that's specifically done, I usually just re-notice the whole thing.
I have another suggestion, I guess. I see Mr. Blake in the audience, and I don't know whether he is interested in appearing before the public hearing, but if he or anybody else is interested in speaking tonight, my suggestion would be to commence the public hearing tonight, since we had advertised it, take whatever comments there might be, and then rather than terminating the public hearing, just if it's opened, then adjourn it to the next meeting, so you literally have a public hearing that encompasses not one but two dates, and thereby we don't make anybody come out again if they don't want to, but certainly they can if they wish.
Any comment? I think that sounds like a fair proposal.
Sounds reasonable.
I think what I'd like to do is, are there members out in our vast audience here that would like to speak at the public hearing? Don't all look around. If you would like to speak, we'll hold part of the public hearing tonight. Otherwise,
I would just wait until Tom and I talked about my letter of concern. We're going to have continuing discussions, and I may have something different to say at that point than I do now.
Okay. Okay. Then I think that being the case, that it'll simply postpone. I think that's Mr. Mitchell out there, not here for the Tom Tinsman?
No.
Applicant for the public hearing? No. I think we'll simply postpone the public hearing until the application is deemed complete, which may or may not be on the December meeting date. Is there any other discussion from the board members? Questions about procedure? If not, do I hear a motion? If you do have questions on the procedure, feel free to ask.
Well, my preference would be to move the second, or to make the second motion, but the suggestion is that that is only applicable after a public hearing. Is that true, Maureen? It seems to me if we don't have a complete application at this point that I would simply like to table to December and see whether we've got a complete application.
That's certainly something you could do. The motions that are drafted here, I mean, there's an infinite number of combinations. I'm just giving
you
a small selection.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I move that it be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Tom Tinsman for site plan review of the conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of office space to a fitness center is tabled to the regular December 1991 Planning Board meeting.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Judy? How are we leaving the public hearing then?
The public hearing has been postponed.
December.
And will be opened if appropriate at that time, if it's found complete.
Right, it wasn't open tonight. Let's just take that issue up after the vote.
Okay.
Okay. Because I do want to settle when we're in, whether we should advertise again or not, okay, and so forth. Is there any other discussion on the motion before us? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. The issue of the public hearing, what are the wishes of the board?
I think we should re-advertise.
Re-advertise for the December meeting, or should we wait? Do we have a time frame to hit for publication? As far as waiting for, if we don't receive the information?
The ad goes in the paper a week before the meeting, and it has to go to the paper 3 days before the day you want it in the paper, so we're talking ten days prior to the meeting.
And the meeting is the 19th.
That's right. So you could make the deadline, the normal deadline for the December 19th Planning Board meeting, which it's 18 days, but because of Thanksgiving, I would be accepting information through December 2nd, which is the day that everyone else will be meeting in order to get on the Planning Board agenda.
So why don't we say that we will advertise if we have in hand all of the items that are the conditional items from Tinsman.
And we'll leave that up to you, Maureen, as to the acceptability of those items. So if we do receive them in the appropriate time frame, we will publish for a public hearing, and this issue, actually by the vote just taken, this will be placed on the December agenda. Thank you. The next order of business under old business is the Davis Wetlands Alteration Permit. Remand by the Superior Court to remove the conditions on the approval granted to Richard Davis allowing fill adjacent to a wetland. We received communication from our town attorney, and hopefully everybody has a chance to read the copy of the court decision. I guess I would just simply like to proceed primarily to see if there are any questions by the board in reference to this.
I have none.
I think as a matter of formality, I would just invite the applicant, if he or she should be here, a representative thereof, if they want to make a short comment. Seeing and hearing none, is there any other discussion?
No.
Okay. Hearing none, do I hear a motion? Don't all jump at once. Judy?
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact. One, Mr. Richard Davis has requested permission to regrade an area of filled land adjacent to a wetland and within previously mapped wetlands. Two, on May 21, 1991, the Planning Board ordered that the area to be regraded did not constitute alteration of wetlands under the pre-May 90 provisions, and that a wetlands alteration permit is not required as long as two conditions of approval are met. Three, Mr. Davis appealed the Board's authority to impose conditions and the Town Planner's authority to request a plan that depicted the conditions. 4. On October 8, 1991, the Superior Court remanded the Davis application back to the Planning Board, finding that once the Planning Board determined that the proposed area is not wetland, it had no authority to impose conditions. Motion. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the decision of the Superior Court in Davis versus Town of Cape Elizabeth, docket number CV 91835, the Planning Board eliminates the following two conditions on the approval granted Richard Davis on May 21, 1991 for regrading of land in the area of Cottage Farms Road. One, there shall be no construction activity, regrading activity, or erosion of soil beyond the hydric soil line depicted on the plan and or into the area labeled Sebago A. Two, the applicant shall submit information depicting the slope ratio of the regraded land as it approaches the hydric soil line and erosion control measures that will prevent erosion into or filling of the Sebago A area to the town engineer for approval.
So.
It has been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Tim?
Does this mean now that a permit is issued without any conditions whatsoever?
That's my understanding. Is that correct?
This is correct.
Would it be possible in the future to issue permit conditions on a wetlands permit that did not grade within these wetlands, but which activity outside the wetlands could impact existing wetlands?
In this particular area or just generally?
In general.
In general, the conclusion of the town attorney is that if the board had selected the wetlands permit process rather than making a finding that it was not impacting wetlands, then these two conditions could have been upheld. So I guess the lesson to be learned is in the future always use the wetlands permit process and follow the procedures, and make sure if you do that you have some authority in the ordinance to impose conditions. But yes, if that option had been followed, then these conditions would not have to be retracted.
In other words, sometimes it's instead of accommodating, it's easier to follow the correct path, I guess, and choose to pursue it from the more lengthy permitting process.
Or in other words, to always check where you have authority in the ordinance and use that authority and don't stray from it.
Good advice.
I must say it still is a little grating that we did this at the request of the applicant only to be have it brought up once again, but I think the vote has, the motion has been made and seconded at this point, so.
Again, I think that's just what we learn when we think we're accommodating, perhaps we're not actually, so. Is there any further discussion? Seeing and hearing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? The vote is 4-1. Tim. Okay. We are running, we're on to new business. The agenda, although it explains that the agenda items, the times on the agenda are approximate to, that they can be earlier or later. As far as the Broad Cove subdivision amendment, Mr. Mitchell, are there other people intended or expected to attend?
Yes, Mrs. Shirley Duncan is supposed to be here.
Okay.
But they had a sudden death in the family. I'm not sure that she's going to make it. So.
Would you prefer that we're several minutes, we're 45 minutes ahead of schedule here?
Is that correct?
Pardon? I want to go ahead and, what are the wishes of the board?
I think so, too.
Is that okay if we proceed?
Yeah.
Okay. Next item of business under new business, it's a Broad Cove subdivision amendment request by Robert and Shirley Dunphy to revise the lot line between lots U38, J32, and U38, J33. Located on Running Tide Road in the Broad Cove subdivision, section 16-2-5. This is new business, and I'd ask a representative of the applicant to give us a brief summary of the application and the proposal. If you could just come to the podium to begin with anyway to identify yourself.
My name is John Mitchell, and I represent Robert and Shirley Dunphy.
Mr. Mitchell, you might want to try to move that bulletin board up a little bit further
okay.
So it'd be easier to see.
Okay. The purpose for this application is to reconfigure and amend the property line which separates lots 32 and 33. Lot 33 is the lot in which Mr. and Mrs. Dunphy reside. The house is located here. And lot 32 is the lot in which the tennis court is situated on. In 1985, Mr. and Mrs. Dunphy constructed a garage located here, which encroached onto lot 32. At the time, it really wasn't an issue because they owned both lots. Now, however, they are considering selling both lots and want to adjust the property line between the two lots so that both lots conform to the zoning ordinance. The yellow line is the original, dating way back to the original subdivision property line. The green line, the green jog in this location represents the line which when the Dunphys built the garage, they changed the lot line and recorded a deed at that time. The red line is the line in which we're proposing currently, and what it does, the reason why it's configured this way is that we have conformed to the minimum setbacks around the garage, and we have also taken the area which amounts to 2,355 square feet, which was taken from Lot 32, and we've put back into Lot 32 with this narrow strip here and this shape here. So that Lot 32 ends up with the same amount of square feet that it originally had when it was subdivided. I believe in your packet, we submitted a letter which was written by the Nichols, which reside across the street from the Dumpies, and I believe that Mr. and Mrs. Moody submitted a letter to the town also.
Mr. Chairman, I have the Nichols letter, but not any letter from the Moody's.
I think this is the original. Thank you, Ms. Mitchell. I think, Maureen, if you could just give us from the staff point of view, an outline of how the board might proceed.
Under section 16.25 in the subdivision ordinance, any change to an approved subdivision, including the changing of lot lines, is required to be brought to the planning board for review. The only other requirement in that section is that upon approval of any amendments, the applicant will submit a recording plat that the board should sign, and that has to be done within 90 days of the approval of the amendment. Other than that, it states that the board may hold a public hearing, but it's not required. And there's no specific requirements as to what is supposed to be submitted, so the board may just want to look at the information they have before them to determine whether they feel they have information that's necessary to make this review, whether anything might be missing. Once you make that determination, your next issue would be to determine whether or not you would want to hold the public hearing on this issue. If you did, you would have to table the application at this time and schedule a public hearing probably for December. If you feel that a public hearing is not necessary, you can begin with the review right at this meeting, and if everything is in order, you could make a motion for some type of approval. Are there any questions?
I guess the first issue is, does the board see a need for a public hearing?
I see no need for a public hearing, and I'm quite satisfied with the amount of information that's been submitted today.
Okay. Tim?
No problem.
Okay, we will forego the public hearing issue. Which puts us to any discussion on the information, a review of the information submitted. Any questions, comments by the board?
Just a general comment. From what I can tell, no one's rights are particularly affected here. It sounds like the assumption always was that this was a buildable lot, whether that was correct or not. And since my other concern was that the line would be very hard to follow, but they are proposing to set iron pins or markers, so I'm very comfortable with this.
Any other questions? I guess the only comment, a question I might have of Maureen, the ordinance states that the width requirement for a lot that was dropped, I can't remember, in, or amended in 83, 84, the issue of narrowing the entry to the, does this come under the jurisdiction of the ordinance as it stood when it was approved, or the current ordinance?
It comes under the jurisdiction of the ordinance that was in effect at the time if they want to maintain their legal non-conforming lot status. The fact that they're narrowing the entrance to the middle lot, as long as they're maintaining a minimum amount of frontage on that lot, and they're not changing the amount of frontage or just narrowing it after a point, is not going to change the legal non-conforming status of the lot. In terms of lot width, we don't have a lot width requirement now, and I have not checked it. I would assume that the lower lot would be wide enough, as just in looking at it, if it appears wide enough, and I I don't know what the lot width
is. Is the 50-foot of frontage the requirement?
I believe this subdivision was one of the subdivisions that had a variable lot frontage requirement. I think 50 feet was the minimum because it does vary widely in that area.
Okay. It's just, and I don't want to dwell on it, it's just an odd way to gain the frontage with the quick cutback, and I've seen them certainly more drastic where it's only 1 foot deep to gain the frontage on the cul-de-sac, for instance. But really without, I mean, the alternative is to take it off the ocean side frontage, and that's probably less desirable to the applicants, I'm sure. Any other discussion? Any questions? Seeing none, hearing none, do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that it be ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Robert and Shirley Dunphy for an amendment to the Broad Cove subdivision, specifically the lot line between lots J33 and J32 on Running Tide Road, be approved in accordance with Section 16-2-5 of the subdivision ordinance.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote.
Thank you. I have the Mylar here. Do you wish to sign that?
Sure.
No. Sure. And I think we can sign it right now. We have one order of other business, but we certainly don't mind, as far ahead of schedule as we are, to take a little time.
Thank you for being so thorough, Mr. Mitchell.
Now that we're 1 hour ahead of time, we have one order of other business. Road standards enclosed for your review prior to the next workshop is a draft matrix of roads grouped by dominant characteristics. This is strictly for board discussion and to assist in our ongoing study of road classification and road standards. Maureen has at the last minute supplied us with a matrix of some of the roads, so the roads that we actually discussed at our workshop. Maureen, if you, while I'm stumbling around trying to find this, could perhaps lead us on with.
I provided that for the board's information prior to the next workshop. I had no intention of it being discussed tonight, but I tried to put in some kind of a matrix form the discussions that happened the last meeting about what roads seem to be similar and why they seem to be similar, and I still haven't in looking at it, figured out how this was going to make anything any clearer, but it's there for whatever useful purpose it may serve.
We are at one of those forming stages of ordinance change, and it's difficult. I think it's essential, or it's good that we have a chance to take a look at this in between workshops, because it's so easy to lose momentum, lose our train of thought where we were. A lot of this came from some brainstorming at the last workshop. I think it's good. I would urge the board one more time before our next workshop to reread the comprehensive plan on the transportation section. I think it starts on page 21, if I'm not mistaken, in the comprehensive plan. Read also the study on visual impact assessment. If you have a copy, you should. If you don't, check with Maureen. There are key issues in that we're considering at least a couple others, and up to 8 different classifications of roads, and all the way back to the discussion of having no classifications of roads. So you can see we're still in the formulating stage. Any discussion or questions from the board? Stephen?
One thing, prior to our next workshop, do we have a list of all the roads in town?
I happen to have on my kitchen little pantry door, I don't know where the map came from. Yes, and that's got a list of, well, yeah, but that's upside. No, it's not.
No, I don't have that.
Well, it's similar to this, but it has a...
Mine is two-colored brown, and it doesn't have a list of roads.
Okay.
I can make copies of that for the board. They come from the assessor's office.
I guess that's where it came from. That would be handy, and that's what I mentioned, if we just took all that whole list of roads, and maybe as we start to compile them into different classifications. I use it so I remember how to get around town before I leave on my errands. But now we've found another use for it. So if we could perhaps have copies of those made up. Would that help?
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Tim?
Yeah, I have a question for you. We should assume that the other roads are listed are in the same category or
more? In going over it, I was assuming that any other road in town would fit into one of those categories or would fit into a category called a minor road.
I assume nothing.
I do want to thank Maureen for putting this part of it together, because we did do a lot of, you know, off the top of the head sort of work last time, and it is helpful to just gather whatever we have together as the
it
place
is.
To start for the next time around.
I guess perhaps just as, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but just as the next step into the next workshop, where would the board like to pick up again? I mean, as far as some suggestions. I guess I say that mainly because should we bring other material like a palette or a writing board? We did some brainstorming and listing of ideas, and sometimes when I'm the only one or Maureen's the only one writing that down, or Alice, we actually had lots of people writing it down. But yeah, sometimes if we can visually see it, it's easier. Would you like to continue in that type of thing, or are we at a stage to start to narrow down classification? We talked about defining classifications. In other words, now that we've got them sort of similar in all of these different type of characteristics, maybe we drop definitions. And I think Judith had numerous definitions for different classifications. Maybe that's another, if we had a list of different types, just to give us ideas of what we would like to group as far as definitions.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the spectrum of characteristics from the traffic use, velocity, cars per hour, to the other end of the spectrum where we talk about more land use versus the actual vehicle use, the land use surrounding the roads. Any suggestions? Janet?
I guess one of the things that occurs to me is that although I like working as a committee of the whole in some respects, in other respects it's might be a time to identify several major issues that we want more info on and break into smaller groups of two or three to do a report back on something. I'm not sure, but that would be something I would consider at this stage, I guess. I'm not sure still what all the implications are of doing a road classification, and if I could either get into it myself or have a report from somebody else about things like that, it would help me.
Mm-hmm. We talked about the constraints of setback by road classification. I lost my train of thought, but
that would be just sort of one small area of, you know, subcommittee work, and there probably would be several other areas.
Probably it's 2 years ago now, but we did a small committee study on infrastructure in the town, and perhaps we broke that committee off a little too early in the process. In other words, we initially, when we decided to study it, just said, how about three people study this and bring it back to the group? I like your idea. Perhaps at the next workshop, we should, as a board, concentrate on maybe three different areas, and we'll split up into groups and report back at a certain date. Okay, this group will work on definitions. This group will work maybe starting on road standards. Maybe it's a little early on road standards, but maybe we'll take a special study on visual assessment and scenic roads, those types of issues.
I kind of thought that if we had a list of the town roads, then maybe we could expand these different categories. Maybe some of them are going to overlap. We can combine some of this, and I think we sort of have to go through that point.
Well, I think that might be one subset where a smaller committee might take the whole list and say, and sit down in the evening in between workshops and go over them and try to place them in whatever groups that we end up with next workshop. And that just be one committee project. And then come back to the full board and say, this is where they've landed. In our little group, what do you think? Can we combine groupings? Is there a need to combine? Should we expand? Should we contract a no characteristic or no classifications?
One more.
Sure.
The characteristics of the roads themselves seem to be the base for how we define the types of road they are. Like Mitchell Road, Fowler's Mill, like you have, Scott Dyer North, have some certain characteristics that other roads in town maybe will have, and that's the form of basis for the definitions themselves. Mm-hmm. That's why I
thought so, okay, maybe we should do that as a group. Okay. Sounds like it certainly might save us an extra month of waiting to come back with what the grouping is. Oh, that is that something we could receive in the mail? A copy of the, or at least a list of the roads? And maybe that would give us a chance if all of the board members would do their own first individual go around with keep this matrix. My mic is on, isn't it, Janet? Thank you for the clue.
I have a question. Who's Mike?
Yeah. Who's Mike? It's an inside joke. I lost my train again. The thought again. Thank you. It is. I'm trying to stall for time. Not really. Okay. If all of the board members could come back, and I guess for this point in time, keep them in these different unnamed categories. There's an extra column over here if you need to throw some in on a minor or whatever, and bring those to the meeting. Judy.
Would also be helpful if Maureen has this kind of information available, is various proposed definitions to work with for classifications. I know Steve mentioned that we might use the characteristics as the starting point or the obvious starting point, whereas a lot of definitions do not. They completely ignore that, and they only use, you know, vehicles per day or what have you. But people have thrown out, I'm not seeing it right now, scenic roads and so forth, just even if they're kind of thrown together definitions, Maureen, something that we could look at and give us thought on how we might refine those later, whether we deal with them next workshop or not. Because even terms like connector, when I look at this connector and I see some are called connectors and others are not, I wonder why, and what is the definition of a connector? What is it connecting? Little things like that would be helpful, I think, to help us categorize.
One of the lists of things that we went over at our last workshop had to do with characteristics, and of course we have the usual vehicles per hour and so forth, but we also have things like, and I was quickly trying to see if they were covered here, but I don't think all of them are, things like sidewalks, setback parking, speed limit, pattern of existing development, the tree edge, continuous and non-continuous tree edge. I think Tom refers to it as solid buffering, maybe. Maybe that's not what he's intending. Community character, lighting, and of course we always return to the scenic issue again. But there are some other terms that I think Judith had numerous definitions from another publication. If we can add those and just keep some of these other terms that we think are important in our own road classification to the forefront when we deal with those.
Mr. Chairman, I guess I'd just like to continue the discussion by saying that maybe it would be helpful to have Judith give that book to Maureen and circulate at least some pages for all of us.
I have that book, and I'll copy those pages and include it in your package for the workshop.
Good. The other thing is, when it makes me think that when I was working on the affordable, when we were working on the affordable housing ordinance, we just got examples of about five different ordinances from around the country that were examples of how to do stuff and not necessarily particularly applicable to Cape Elizabeth, but they were helpful in giving the range. Now, maybe that's not going to work here.
Well, unfortunately, you've already received the best that I've been able to come up with in terms of examples. And, I think there was an article that was written by a traffic engineer, and then there was the other end of the spectrum where there were the notes from the a man by the name of Walter Kulash, who spoke at the conference, and he talked about roads in a different manner. He didn't just use vehicles per hour, but they're really, I'm not aware of any ordinance that does anything more with road classifications than just standards and widths and classify them by number of vehicles that are on there. We have definitions for roads in our subdivision ordinance, and they're very broad, simple definitions that it seems this board has gone a lot further than those definitions at the first meeting.
Thank you.
Any chance of getting the survey that was passed out to the townspeople and they responded to? Just for sort of a little bit of an input as to
in reference to the comprehensive plan?
Is it in there? It is in there.
It's an appendix to the comprehensive plan.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that.
It's one of the first ones in there.
Again, reading or rereading those two publications, the comprehensive plan and the visual assessment. Also, we regathering the infamous March 5th. Does everybody have copies of those? I collect and keep all my things in these little folders, so we should be compiling quite a pile of things now. Any other discussion on road classifications? Any things we want to remember to bring forward? I see Maureen taking notes, so I'm sure we'll get a little bit of a summary and a good summary, I'm sure, to go into the next workshop. Any further discussion? Maureen?
Not related to road classifications, but since you did raise the issue, I thought the board might be interested to know that at the last council meeting, the council did adopt the affordable housing provisions.
Very good. Do you know, and just off, do you know what type of progress they're making on the mandatory shoreline zoning ordinance?
The shoreline zoning ordinance was accepted from the ordinance committee to the council at the last council meeting, which was last Wednesday. They've scheduled a public hearing on it for December 9th. And copies of it are available in my office and at the library.
Any changes? Any thing to report back from the ordinance committee?
Yes, they did make some changes. They eliminated campgrounds as a permitted use, was one of the things they worked on for a while. And there were some other changes, but nothing that comes to mind right now that was really significant. It was a lot of just tightening up things more.
Okay. Tim?
Maureen, was there any public testimony at the affordable housing hearing?
None.
Any other questions, comments? Any other new business? Other business?
What's the status of the sewer ordinance before the council?
I don't believe that the council is proceeding forward with that at this time. Well, there
can
are
you say anything more? Is it in committee, in the ordinance committee, or?
No, it's not. The council has a lot of priorities, and it's one of them, but it's not one of the things they're working on right now.
I know the board is trying very desperately to make it till 8 o'clock to keep this meeting going, but unless there's any other discussion, I'll adjourn this meeting.